Welcome to our webinar, Becoming the Technologically Savvy Distributor, How to Drive a Seamless Customer Experience. My name is Rich Verva. I'm editor and publisher of Industrial Supply Magazine. We're joined today by Rod Butters, Chief Technology Officer for Canandy. Our sponsor for the webinar is Canandy. Canandy's cloud ERP empowers business innovation. Built on the Salesforce platform, Canandy has redefined enterprise resource planning by allowing customers to map to their existing business processes. If you want to learn more, you can visit on the web, canandy.com. That's K-N-A-N-D-Y.com. Just a couple of housekeeping issues as we get started. All of the participants will be muted during the presentation, but if you would like to ask a question, feel free to use the chat feature. And we'll do our best to answer your questions. During the webinar, we'll also have a couple of opportunities for you to participate in polls where you can tell us what you think on some of the topics we'll be discussing. Please watch for those opportunities when they come up to express your opinion. Today's webinar will help you answer several questions. Number one, are you a technologically savvy distributor? Can you keep up with customers who are used to instant responses and real-time information that is so prevalent today? Do your technology systems allow you to integrate information in real time to provide better tracking and to provide better visibility to improve operational efficiency and decision making? Do your technology systems help you innovate, or are you being left behind because you aren't keeping up with technology changes? Well, that's all the kind of stuff that we're going to be talking about today. And instead of me rambling on, why don't I hand it over to Rod Butters. Good day, Rod. Glad you could join us.
Oh, absolutely, Rich, and thanks for hosting us today. I really appreciate it. There we go. So thanks for that great introduction as well. And as part of our agenda today, some of the things that I thought would be good for us to talk through is start off with a little bit of the disruption that's happening and or the trends that are happening in the market that are creating disruption for a lot of businesses today. I mean, it's obvious how many things are changing in industry and how businesses are needing to adapt, whether they like the changes or not. The other topic that is really talk about some of the things that are happening with cloud and how cloud can actually be leveraged in this environment and what makes up cloud. And then we'll talk about some of the benefits on how cloud supports distribution. And Rich, I know you've got a lot of interesting insights with all the connections you have with your readership and the people that are connected with your publication. And then I'll follow up with a few examples. So we go through this. Looking forward to the discussion.
Yep.
So just kind of kick this off. One of the things that's really changing a lot of things. I know you see this is just the way that connectivity is transforming absolutely every facet of industry of not only the businesses themselves, but how they connect with others, but even how the products are changing. And one of the predictions out there is that shortly here we'll be in a world where there's 75 billion smart things connected, which I think may be getting to the point that we're all outnumbered, if anybody worries about that. But some of the things that are connected, of course, everybody's getting more and more familiar with the connected vehicle and just not only how much the vehicle has changed in a relatively short amount of time as far as things go, but also the fact that the vehicle is really, truly already become an endpoint for providing information to the driver as well as providing back information about driving, the kinds of things that come up, and all these issues. And it's really that vehicle has become really a two-way street that I think is Sorry, I had no idea that pun was going to come out.
Nice pun. Right. They make you smarter. They tell you when you need to change your oil. They tell you when you need to add air in your tires.
Well, for me, I'm looking forward to when it makes me a better driver.
There's only so much technology can do, Rob.
That could definitely be an improvement. And the other thing that's interesting is just how all of our personal devices, of course, that really set the stage for a lot of these things, but all of our personal devices have really become this communication conduit, not only for providing information back, but also providing different kinds of services. So I don't think there's anyone among us that's not familiar with our PDA, if not our smartphone, if not even our watch. And even inside the home, things like the smart thermostats and things like this are turning many, many things into this conduit that's providing new services in the form of information or in the form of some type of service in terms of either providing you control, providing you information, driving your car. And I think the interesting impact of this is what people are looking at and what they plan on doing about this. I think that it's remarkable the number of businesses at this point. In this particular survey conducted by Salesforce, 74% of the executives they spoke to said they were actually looking at how they would create data-driven services. And not only that potentially the data-driven service piece, even for a product or distribution company, would be a primary source of revenue. And we do see this as that switch from just providing the product to providing that full service around it is starting to really have an impact on businesses that understand how to embrace that. A key piece of that is how do you actually make that information connection in real time? And that's not just necessarily to provide a service, but even as a way of building a better relationship with the customers. And, you know, this is something that I think is really shifted. I know that for a long time, we've all talked about how CRM and maintaining the customer relationship is so key. One of the things that I think is really important to think about as you're looking at it from this perspective and is that it changes it from something that's an afterthought to something that's core to managing the relationship with the customer. Well, let me give you an example. I mean, there's this idea, you know, that you could send out a follow-on email or you could send out a follow-on piece of information to offer some kind of different offering or product or something like that to a customer. And that's kind of trying to extend that relationship beyond a transactional event. But when you start thinking about a lot of these different things becoming more of a data-driven service, like providing vendor-managed inventory or providing the service or the product or offering as a subscription or a rental or a metered usage rather than just a delivery of a product, that suddenly changes the CRM from something that's a after-the-fact type of thing to an inline kind of activity. I think that's a really key distinction that I think people need to think about. And I think this is even key for distributors. We have distributors of, say, industrial pumps that are really dramatically changing the model from just, I'm going to send a pump out the door and sell it to you, and I might add a few fixtures to it too, an ongoing interaction with the customer. Do you need more pumps right now? We can provide these on a subscription, on a rental basis. We can provide them as metered usage. We can make sure that when we're providing it, it has appropriate service life on it for the particular installation, the timeline you're doing it. That suddenly changes what I think historically CRM was, which was this welded on after the fact thing, to very much in line with how you're interacting with the customer. And mm-hmm. I don't know if you can think of examples, but I do think that is a real shift away from the way people used to think about these, where they would get these different systems set them up versus how do you have this holistic view.
Right. Well, and customers, often different customers want different types of solutions, and distributors have to be able to be nimble enough to provide that flexibility for the customer. This slide makes me think, when I think about distributors today, many of them are using a lot of different systems. You know, some are installed in the office, some are installed in the warehouse, and it can actually, you know, it can kind of be a nightmare to try to manage all of that data between all those disparate systems. So, you know, one question they might ask is, well, where do I start to move to the cloud? Do I do it with my CRM? Do I do it with my ERP, with my warehouse management system? You know, what do you suggest to distributors when they ask that question?
Well, I think there's two parts. One, the first one, I think you've already kind of acknowledged, which is that, and this is our thought, is that it's a lot simpler when you have these systems on the cloud, because like you point out, when you have a warehouse system, and even warehouse systems, a lot of times there'll be the warehouse system, and then there's actually the system for managing scanners, and then there's the system that actually manages the, you know, the transportation, there's the system that manages the inventory, all these different things. And on the cloud, what we've really found and what our customers find is that those distinctions both blur, and the integration of those sources of information basically in many cases just dissolves away, because having all of the information and capabilities on one environment or in an environment that very readily connects together basically helps eliminate a lot of those different systems, or even the need for some of those different systems. For example, we had a very large CPG company, and CPG companies, if you're familiar with them, they're probably 90% distribution, 10% manufacturing. And they actually had 110 different systems in place. They eliminated 90 of them by moving to a cloud solution and got everything consolidated on a cloud. So that's very much the case. So I really do think that the cloud offers an interesting way to do this. And you bring up the second point, which is, okay, but if I got all these different systems, how do I plan out a transition if I'm really going to go this direction? And from my perspective, I think one of the key things really does start with the ERP. And the reason for that is really twofold. One, ERP is really the thing that drives a lot of those core processes to drive the whole order to cash process, to drive the actual information about fulfillment, to understand what you need to do from a planning perspective. But secondly, the ERP typically is a repository for all of the master data in the environment. For mid-sized companies, that ERP ends up as that information backbone. And getting that master data right, your customers, your suppliers, item master, costing information, all those key things onto the cloud really creates a foundation then to really launch into all these other different directions to either bring those capabilities onto the cloud or in many cases be able to eliminate separate systems entirely. Well, that's my thoughts.
Very good. Yeah, distributors often like to talk about how their most important asset is their people, and I have no quarrel with that, but what ERP system they're using and how well they utilize it ought to be a close second, because that often can make the difference.
Yeah, and I would completely agree with that, and one of the interesting things that we've found is that in traditional environments, the communication between people typically ends up going around the ERP system, whether it's through spreadsheets or people having to pick up the phone and hunt people down, or other types of things, what we find with the cloud-based approach, and this is interesting because this isn't necessarily inherent to the ERP functionality itself, it's more inherent to the cloud infrastructure, is that they begin using the ERP as a point of collaboration. So within our ERP, for example, it has things where they can chat, they can record conversations, they can use it really as a full-blown substitute to all the other types of communication, even to the extent of cutting down on the amount of email, because they're putting the communication right in the system. And so as a way of empowering people, I've really seen some amazing things happen as people do move to the cloud and start leveraging these technologies.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that I thought was interesting, Gartner recently wrote, and it was kind of interesting because as they wrote this, we read it, it just really rang true, which is that in many respects, ERP is undergoing a fairly significant change in how people even think about the ERP. Because one of the things that we've seen is interesting is in a cloud environment, a lot of times the connectivity and the flexibility actually ends up displacing what historically was a view of ERPs as something that needed a lot of deep functionality. And so rather than deep functionality with lots and lots of configuration options and those types of things, what we find is that people can get a lot more out of the ERP by being able to have an ERP that provides more flexibility, that gives them a way to make it match to their business and their processes, rather than trying to fit into all the configuration options. So it does end up being a different approach. And Rich, I think right now we're going to take a minute and do a survey to just find out what
people thought on. We mentioned we're going to find out what our readers are thinking. So our first poll question is, how many of you have moved to the cloud? Feel free to select that if that's your answer. How many of you have plans to move to the cloud within this year? Are you considering a move to the cloud? Or do you have no plan to move? So let's see what kind of answers we might get from our participants. And if the technology works, you should be able to just click on one of those buttons to register your answer.
So is this the point where we okay.
Okay, we're getting some answers. Very good.
Well, that's very interesting. Clearly we've got a lot of people that are thinking about this and are looking to do this. So thanks all for joining us today.
Yeah, so at least people are considering a move. I was surprised to see how many have actually already moved, but that sort of tells you people who would attend a webinar like this are the early adopters, and they're wanting to make sure that they're on top of things.
Well, that's fantastic. So all of you that have already moved, you're dismissed.
Well, maybe they've moved somewhere else, and you want them to move to Canandy.
No, this is great. Well, I'm glad to see that. No, that's fantastic. Just to go to our next topic, I think, Rich, you had some interesting perspectives from your side on the move to cloud and some other thoughts on this.
Yeah, we've run a few articles on this topic fairly recently, and one of them was this article, Cloud Computing Paradise or Peril, happened to be written by an organization called the Distributor Board, which is a group of guys who used to be owned distribution companies in the Chicago area and now are consulting to distributors of various types. And you know, they often are faced with distributors thinking about, should we be moving our technology to the cloud? It's something we've heard about. But you know, some of the reasons they do it is maybe they had a server failure and they've lost some data. Or maybe they're trying to reduce expenses and they'd heard that the cloud was cheaper than what they're doing today. They recognize that maintaining hardware is expensive, and they don't really want to be focusing their attention on that. And also, just because technology changes so fast, it can be hard for a distributor to keep up. So those are all the kinds of things that distributors are sort of grappling with. I know that the hardware issue is a big issue with distributors. And is that one of the reasons, Rod, that you feel a lot of distributors tend to want to migrate to the cloud so that they don't have to be responsible for this anymore? Let's let the experts handle that.
Well, I do see a lot of people when they initially look at cloud. I think there's two things that are driving that. One is the, you know, in some cases I would describe it as the complete exhaustion of dealing with trying to not only maintain the hardware or upgrade the hardware, but keep the right software on the hardware. I mean, there's so many times I've talked to people who have an ERP and the last time they upgraded anything around it was almost a decade ago. And it, you know, that puts the business at risk. It typically means that, you know, it was probably set up by somebody who's no longer around, and so if you're going to set up another system that's on-premise to upgrade it, you're probably going to have to go out and find the talent or find the people resources. And it's something that again, it's not an easy thing to maintain. But I do think there's a lot of things beyond just the obvious benefits. I think this is an interesting point. I wanted to include this point in the discussion. We should recently, Frost & Sullivan did a review of Canandy and looked at our architecture. I think in their paper they actually did a fabulous job of really describing what it was that we've been able to do different with the cloud. But I would describe our processes as Canandy has gone through and created an ERP on the cloud. You know, when we initially got into this, we really thought about it from those perspectives of, hey, the cool thing about cloud is you don't have to maintain that hardware, you don't have to do those things. But where we really ended up with is that the cloud has some interesting benefits way, way, way above and beyond that. Most notably is not only does it help you cut out the number of different systems, but it gives you an information source that's much easier to understand. We can get the entire schema of the ERP into about 150 tables. We actually call them business-ready objects to really get people to think about how these can be very different, but it really gives the company that access to the data that's been difficult in the past. In the past, you know, you typically have to have separate reporting solutions. You might have to have a data warehouse if you've got a large data set you're trying to report on. We can get all the information in one place and make it extremely accessible to people. The other thing that I think has been so shocking to me about cloud is how the cloud, and particularly when you look at a multi-tenant environment, can be so strikingly different in terms of the resources it can provide. You know, one of the classic things that happens for distributors or manufacturers is that they'd like to run MRP, but I got to tell you, most mid-market companies have abandoned that long ago and basically gone just to spreadsheets because MRP historically has been really hard to provision your hardware for, and typically when you run it, it takes out the entire business for a day, a weekend, an afternoon, whatever, while you have to shut everybody else and go run the out and go run the MRP. With the cloud, we found that not only can you run the MRP anytime, it doesn't really require any resources. It's because it's truly an elastic environment where that resource is really available on demand. And so our customers can run MRP at any time. It doesn't slow down any user's performance. You can have people in the warehouse doing scanning to the system, people doing live reports, looking at dashboards, all those things. Nobody gets slowed down. Not only that, I mean, this would be crazy. You could do it if you want to, but 10 people could go in and all run MRP at the same time, and the cloud will just instantly scale up and support that. And I was really surprised to learn the other day. I was talking with a distributor that actually was looking to see what Candy could do for them. They were already on the cloud, and I said, "Well, you're on the cloud. What? Why would you want something different?" And they said, "Well, it's so slow. We can't just do the MRP anytime." And I think that's really an indication of what has actually happened to the technology underneath that, because anybody's been able to spray paint cloud on anything they've got. The question is it that multi-tenant? And primarily that multi-tenancy really means it's an elastic architecture. And not only is it up to date, not only is it the hardware and all those things, but it's really truly on demand. And that suddenly makes the cloud very, very different from something you could ever, ever, ever contemplate doing with hardware in your own data room.
I guess you've kind of answered my next question, but I wanted to play devil's advocate, which is, you know, every ERP vendor, it seems, has some sort of a cloud solution. You know, if I'm a distributor, why don't I just stick with my ERP vendor? Does the platform really matter?
Oh yeah, and I think it truly does. You know, that's a great lead into kind of the next thing I wanted to cover, which is, you know, who's providing the cloud to you. And one of the things that we've really leveraged is the Salesforce platform. That's where our cloud ERP actually runs. It runs in their data centers on their environment. What's interesting about this to me is this, so it does have all the hardware, the elasticity, the, you know, upgrades, but the other part of this is the amount of trust that I know that I can put into our customers' data being on the Salesforce cloud platform. I never lose sleep on security issues, backup issues, scalability, reliability. And this has been an interesting thing as well. I mean, we get, multinational companies that look at a Canadian solution, and they have a whole team of people many times who supports all the requirements for compliance, security, all these types of things that will go in and do an extensive review, far more than many of us, you know, mid-sized companies could ever imagine doing. And I'm always pleased to see the results of that, because Salesforce has just done a fantastic job making sure that it supports the security, and that security is both attacks from outside as well as authorization and authentication from within. So it's easy for us to support compliance requirements, which I know many mid-sized companies, as they think about their growth plans, all know that at some point they're going to have to meet, if they don't already, meet all the types of compliance requirements that would be required as they change their ownership or as they evolve as a company. To be sure of having the backup and the reliability, the information backup, and to have full fault tolerance and failover in terms of catastrophic disaster. But also just that reliability element. Another thing I like about the Salesforce platform is they have a page. It's called trust.salesforce.com, which anyone can go to. You don't have to be a Salesforce customer to go to it. Anyone can go to it anytime and see the full status of all their data centers and see any outage, any information about those, full transparency. That's fantastic. And you know, the other thing that makes it easier for me to sleep at night is the fact that I know that Salesforce is really fantastic in terms of their viability. They're extremely well managed. They're obviously become a global company at this point. So I think anyone who is using our ERP can be very assured that the information is reliable, it's available, and that's just critical for a warehouse operation that will be using scanners, and they'll be scanning directly back to the cloud. That's one of the great things. There's no hardware in-premise for managing scanners or printers. Be able to make sure that information is reachable anyplace. And just know that it's got this amazing operation behind it. that is managing these world-class data centers throughout the world. So I do think it matters.
I suspected you would.
And again, it's been interesting because we've had a lot of experience working with Salesforce over almost 6 years now, and it's been amazing to watch how they've evolved, how they've extended the capabilities, and they've just been a fantastic partner for us to work with every step of the way. So this is a kind of an interesting topic. I know that you all have published on, which is this whole idea of data. I was hoping you could take some time and talk a bit more about this from your perspective.
Yeah, this is another article that we ran recently called Are You a Modern Distributor? Just the idea is that as more companies are using the internet to gather information about products or where they should buy their products, should they buy them online, should they buy them direct from the manufacturer, it's forcing distributors to have to provide shorter lead times, more value-added services to attract customers. So the purpose of this article that we're referencing here is they talk about a modern distributor. And define that type of organization as being a company that's growing, a company that's insightful, they're effective, they're responsive, and they're collaborative. You know, when I think about some of the better distributors that I've come across over the years, many of them are excellent at providing customer service because they understand the products they sell. They might be a cutting tool distributor, and they know how to go onto a machining center floor and say, let us analyze what you do and we can help you reduce your downtime, we can help you improve your productivity, whatever it might be. Or they might be a safety distributor and they help them pick just the right product to keep their workforce safer, or a hose distributor that helps them assemble and cut and put together the kinds of materials they need when they need it. But even all these people who are great and have great knowledge about what they're selling to the customer, they still have to keep up with the technology because the customer wants all that stuff that the distributor was traditionally offering them, but in addition, they want to be able to do it over the internet, for example, or they want to have other data that maybe the distributor can provide to them. So the distributor has to kind of be able to provide all of the above for, the modern distributor has to be able to provide all of the above for today's demanding customer.
Well, I think that's a fantastic point. I think that that's a great point in terms of how that is impacting distributors and how they participate in the supply chain. I think that you had suggested we actually run another survey here at this point. Maybe you could describe this and let's get it out to our audience to see what they think.
Yes, here's your chance to voice your opinion once again. Have you tackled the data conundrum? Yes, I currently have a system in place to tackle data. No, but I plan on having a system in place to tackle data. Or no, and I have no plans to tackle data. So we'll give you a second to ponder those three choices. And then we'll take a look at the results. We'll see if you do just as good at answering these questions, this as you did the first one. Give you just a couple of more seconds to answer those polling questions. And we're ready to see some results. So a lot of people are doing some thinking about what they need to do.
No, I think this is a very interesting result.
And maybe, you know, you dismissed people before who already had systems. Maybe now it's time to dismiss the people who say, they have no plan in place, they don't want to do it. You know, then why are you here?
Well, they're curious, and I think that's good. But I do think it's very interesting, and I think the fact that people recognize the problem, but they want to understand how they're going to address it, I think that is an indication of, you know, the role that, data does play in connecting with customers, connecting with the supply chain, but also the challenge right now today in actually doing anything with that. I think it's an indication. I was going to talk for a couple minutes about, you know, some of the things that we see and how data comes to play in this. And it's interesting. I always like to remind people of what ERP of old used to actually do and what people used to think of in terms of what automation was supposed to provide. In a very linear value chain, what happens is that at each link in the chain, people basically are trying to achieve most cost-effective operations. They're trying to create repeatable processes that can be as efficient as possible, that can eke out every single piece of opportunity to cut the costs and be more competitive in the entire value chain. And the thing there is that the systems, and this is, you know, systems of 20 years ago, 30 years ago, were really about how do I identify the process and then how do I automate it to the nth degree so that I could make that absolutely reproducible in terms of eking out all of those costs and inefficiencies. But the challenge that happens, and I think this is what people are seeing when they're trying to figure out how do they provide these new services, how do they leverage the data, how do they become part of that connectivity, is the fact that the ecosystem is really becoming something that spans that entire channel all the way from the business to the actual end users inside of the business to even in some cases the end customer. And so the question really becomes one of where does that data come from and how do I connect to it and how do I have a system that's more focused on information and flexibility in the processes rather than eking out every last bit of efficiency in a particular process step. And that's where I think, you know, when ERPs were built in decades past, they did a really good job supporting those goals in the economy when it was really about scale up and efficiency, which put them at a distinct disadvantage in dealing with a world where now it's about data and connections and process. And so I do think that cloud puts people at a distinct advantage relative to traditional systems. So it's no longer just about, hey, I got somebody else managing the hardware, but it's really about how do I leverage the data to provide more service, provide more information. How do I see what kinds of things people are ordering? What kinds of modifications is somebody requesting on that hose? How frequently are people pulling cutting materials and braces out of a vending machine I put on site? How can I recommend to them that they might use different products and services from me to be more effective in servicing their end customer based on getting that additional insight into who they're servicing as well? So I do think that it's really changed. And again, I do think that on a cloud, we can offer people something that's very different in terms of the ability to participate in this.
There is so much data available today, and it's just a matter of how quickly can you access the data, and now how do you put that data into use that's going to, yes, increase your sales and your profitability, but also help the customer solve problems.
Absolutely. I'm going to talk about some examples that kind of hit this from three different vantage points. And I think these are interesting customers that we pulled up to actually look at in terms of how a cloud solution really changed the way they thought about some of their things. So first one really is a company that, you know, earlier I mentioned CPG companies, a lot of times you should think of them as 90% distribution and, you know, 10% manufacturing. In this case, Summit Foods actually is primarily distribution and service, not the actual manufacturing. And their target market is really to provide prepackaged food to school cafeterias. They started out identifying an opportunity in the market. They leverage the same tools many small companies start with QuickBooks, and suddenly find themselves with a lot of Excel. But what they really see as a value prop and a way to look at this business is that they really are looking at how they're managing this entire connection all the way from farm to the school, and being able to have transparency into that value chain. And for them, this was a key point in terms of what kind of solution would help them get to that amount of supply chain visibility, that amount of data access, that amount of information in terms of being able to really manage not just the information in the manufacturing process, but really information in that whole chain of custody all the way from the original farmer producer to the actual endpoint. And that's something that they've been able to do by leveraging the cloud. And not only that, we're able to find other benefits in that as well, because not only did it give them this differentiated leverage in terms of being able to use the data about the supply chain, but even allowed them to track all of their business in terms of processes and execution and response to really service very, very large customers. So they manage providing product to some of the major school systems throughout the U.S. and have really turned what originally was a small concept and a focused market into what's growing into a very lucrative business for them, and providing a really new service for the schools. So I think this is a great example of getting both internal process improvements and becoming a more responsive distributor, but really now providing a value prop that is very differentiated in the market in terms of serving this important part of the economy.
Those comments that come right after that sentence that you've highlighted in red, change the way they did business, you know, that's very sobering. You know, as a distributor, you think you have demanding customers. Something's going wrong with a product that's being distributed in a school where your children are. You've got some customers who really want to know, how are you going to deal with this? What's your answer going to be?
Oh, absolutely. And I think that the other thing that's coming out of this is that as companies, as businesses like Soma provide this kind of capability for schools, something that's very visible in the market, this puts pressure on other parts of the economy and other sectors to provide this kind of visibility as well. I think increasingly it's not only consumers, but it's businesses that provide that expect that kind of transparency into where do products come from, how were they sourced, how were they handled, and so I think food industry, these highly visible markets, like you say, medicine, supply of vaccines, all these things, is setting a new high bar, but it's really expected from many people that everyone ultimately should be able to provide this type of data, this type of information and service. So I couldn't agree with you more, Rich.
Yeah, that's a good example. You've got another one now. Let's move on to that one.
Yeah, so another one for us is Primus Power, and I think this is interesting because this is looking at it from the other side. Primus they create grid-level storage systems, and what was so important to them is that this is rapidly evolving technology. They can make engineering changes that they would really like to get into their supply chain in the same day. And one of the things that moving to the cloud helped them with is to get that integration of the actual product design, the engineering changes, all of those things integrated right into their supply chain. And they were able to do this in really less than 3 months, so that when they actually have a change to a design or they see an issue that's showing up in the field, they can trace that back through the supply chain almost immediately. And that created a very new type of velocity, as well as, again, an opportunity for them to cut costs in their business. So they actually have a great relationship then and great visibility with their suppliers. And I think that distributors should be thinking about how they stay ahead of this, because I think as businesses evolve, as they create new requirements, as they start rethinking the market, they want their distributors to be equipped to participate in that as well. Another interesting example, which might seem a little far afield to some of our distributors, but it's a great example of someone who really utilizes the equipment. And what they did was change relationships, so providing the equipment as a service, not a capital expense. And really, a number of different pieces of the business. Suddenly, they're looking at more like a distributor in terms of how they do run out of the service, how they do the customer. This is a great example of how you can reach out a much better relationship. I mentioned this earlier with our customer provided industrial pumps. They're really moving to this model where they don't just provide the pump itself, but they're really providing that in the server around it. And you mentioned it with your customers, you've seen your readers that are doing things like post-distribution or creating types of products out of those. So I really want to mention the data. As you move these models as well and start participating in this broader type of ecosystem, another thing you tend to run into as services is even with pricing and billing costs, as you begin to have customers that participate in buying groups or marketing groups. They need to buy under different contracts, able to manage that contract and relationship and do those pricing. And we saw the same thing in the last deal with Phillips, to be able to provide those consolidated invoices under contract all the way down to smaller distributors working with, say, regional groups of companies that are participating in those types of group purchases or organizations. So it's a really great example of how an ecosystem can be created by leveraging technology. So our point, the world is changing. Businesses need to look at how to participate in the supply chain in new and different ways. Distributors are really a part of that, and I really love to look at how they leverage cloud because they really need to get back by all these different solutions, all these different systems that are trying to integrate together. They really need to provide this to the customer. They need to provide integration data, and you just don't think this is another way to do it than to really leverage our cloud and a true cloud-based solution. So, I don't see anything else. I'm getting a video here from Austin Paul, whether something else right now.
I'd love to have the name, maybe after that we ask a few questions.
Okay, perfect. All right, so if you have questions, let me see here.
Well, that's right. We skip that part. Is that video available on your website if anybody wants to look at it?
Yeah, I think so. I'm sure it is. Follow up and to the video.
All right. Yeah, I asked you earlier, it's a very interesting video. I think people understand. Well, we have a few questions before we wrap things up. One of the questions that someone has asked is, we had some implement our ERP system. So you understand you're kind of reluctant to move. How difficult is a cloud ERP implementation, and how long does it typically take to get running?
That's a great question. Glad that folks were about that. One of the challenges, there's kind of two parts of it. One of the challenges with traditional ERP systems is that it's not going to come out. Unfortunately, it's much like putting that cake in the oven, and you can't know what it's like until you actually talk it out and give it a try. Thing we found about a kind of that we bring some of the modern ideas of agile development right into implementation of cloud ERPs. In fact, with our customers, many times we encourage them very early on, almost from day one, to start getting their data into the system, start loading and start looking at it. This was cool with cloud information. You can get it in the system almost immediately and start seeing more data playing through the business processes. So I think that's one thing that can make implementations so very, very different is that people can see, get their hands on, and understand and have good familiarity with the system long before it goes live. In terms of how long does it take to get that running, we have seen people take on very long deployments in little 3 months. And a lot of that is just depending on how quickly can you get your data, how committed are the members of the team, can they dedicate time to getting into the system and understanding what it's doing and where it might need to do something different for their business. So I have seen people that work with us to get about 3 months and help businesses vary in terms of what they can commit to actually being involved. But I think there's no substitute for getting in and working towards an aggressive timeline, because the longer these implementations drag out, and this is the challenge with traditional ERP, is that they drag out the that the organization can become very fatigued, become very costly, and can end up not knowing exactly what you get until you pull on the switch. So that's
Who do you recommend to participate in an implementation project? The reason I ask is people think when you're doing something like this, well, that's IT, you just hand it all off to the IT, but that's not necessarily where it should end. Wouldn't you want to involve management people as a part of that as well in various functions within the company?
Greatest success I see is when people do involve multiple functions within the company. As a matter of fact, one of our customers, Stratus, they actually started the whole ERP process with the sales organization. That if we have something that doesn't support the sales organization, the whole project would fail, because it really is about creating proxy for the business, creating visibility. And so whether it should be sales, it should be the operations team, it should be the warehouse manager, it should be finance folks, it should definitely be executive management and sponsorship and air cover for the project. So I really think the more holistic people can look at this, the more successful it will be for the whole business.
Mm-hmm. And I have one other question, and then probably have to be wrapping things up. But I know it's difficult to talk about cost, as that can vary, of course, depending on what people are currently doing. But can you talk about give some sort of way to measure payback so people know if they're getting value?
That's a great that's a great question, Rich. What I've seen is that payback is so much dependent on what the business's goals are, what the challenges are, and how they do that. And I've seen paybacks come in many different forms. For example, we had one customer that their payback was because for the first time felt they truly had real-time view into their inventory levels and could really begin managing overall inventory, not getting into overstock situations, having good advanced visibility where they have shortages and have cuts. And actually found that they became much, much more efficient in terms of managing their buying process and the supply chain. I've also seen great examples where people have managed to really have a major impact on the business just with the time it takes to get an order into the system. So many people have challenges, whether it's pricing, product availability, sourcing, selecting distribution centers to ship from, and being able to either cut that time by making people more effective, or in some cases, we've customers that have opted 60-70% of their actual orders, so they become touchless. That can have a major impact. So all those are things that for those businesses translate directly into dollars. And what was interesting to me is that the major metric was not, does it cut me the cost of IT, does it cut me the cost of the system? The major metrics were the true business buyers that said, can I process those orders faster? Can I get better feedback from the customers? Can I reduce the, you know, the inefficiency in my operations? Those were the drivers that drove the actual ROI on move to that technology.
Oh, very good. I greatly appreciate all the time that you've given us today. We're kind of running out of time, so we'll have to wrap things up here. We will have an archived version of this webinar available on our website, industrialsupplymagazine.com. We'll be sending out some mail blasts distance as well, in case there's anyone else wanted to invite to watch in this very informative webinar. Thank you very much for your time, Ron. Is there anything else that you'd like to say just as a final thought?
There's no time like present. Just say, I don't think the class is getting better by waiting. I think it's here, and I think that the companies to figure out how to leverage this soon are going to be in a better position for the future.
Very good. I appreciate your time again. If anyone wants more information, please feel free to visit canandy.com on the web. If you'd like to get in touch with me, I'd be happy to pass along Rob's contact information to you if you want to know more. So thank you again for joining us for today's webinar. Thank you to Rod Butters and to Canandy for being our sponsor. So all of you have a great day. Goodbye.